no one can doubt that the possibility that Madeleine had been abducted by a paedophile was raised right from the outset, not least by the McCanns themselves. It was on the very first night when the alarm about Madeleine being missing was raised that the McCanns themselves first suggested that paedophiles snatched Madeleine. The Portuguese police files contain hundreds of witness statements. One was Graham McKenzie, and this is his account of events at about 11 p.m. to midnight, an hour or two after the McCanns had reported Madeleine missing. I approached the McCanns' apartment from the bushes at the rear of the apartment. I did not know it was the McCanns' apartment at the time. I was searching in the little gardens on the poolside of that block. I was in the end garden. I heard and saw Jerry McCann standing alone in the doorway at the rear of the apartment on the balcony stroke patio about 3 metres away, talking on his mobile. Dr. McCann was looking over the swimming pool and did not see me. Dr. McCann was absolutely distraught, his voice cracking with emotion, telling the person receiving the call that he feared she, Madeleine McCann, had been taken by paedophiles and that there were paedophile gangs in the area and that they had abducted Madeleine. I do not know who the person receiving the call was, but presume it was a family member or someone he was very close to due to the nature of his conversation. I was so shocked by this, having originally thought that she had just wandered off. I think we need to contemplate this statement from the perspective that Madeleine was already dead and that Jerry McCann was fully aware of this. So it was Jerry McCann himself who was apparently telling people he feared Madeleine had been taken by one or more paedophiles. He was the first off the blocks to offer up this word. The media instantly took up the theme, with many newspapers giving accounts of other snatches by paedophiles. But none of these very rare snatches by paedophiles remotely resembled the McCanns' scenario. In the months that followed her claimed disappearance, the McCann team went on to make numerous references, counted in dozens, to the probability that Madeleine had been abducted by paedophiles. So-called experts on child sexual abuse and paedophilia soon appeared in the press and on TV to pronounce on their theories on the case. I want to mention two of them. The late Ray Wire, founder of the Gracewell Clinic for treating sex offenders, and Mark Williams Thomas, a former police officer, self-styled criminologist and TV pundit.
You have evidence to back up stories like Teresa's, that this is really happening?
Well, we have that age of child, 6, 5 and 4, giving information that ties up with Teresa. How do those children know? How do those children able to describe rituals, to talk about ceremonies, to talk about sacrificing animals? How do those children know?
Nightmares, imagining it?
You can't imagine those things.
Less than 1 week after Madeleine was reported missing, the Daily Telegraph published an article by Wire on the case. I have worked with men who have abducted and killed children. Often their capture has failed to save the child and has not come about through good police work. The planning needed to take the child cannot be overestimated. It was clear from the beginning in Portugal that we were dealing with an abduction and the need to think offender was essential. What was his motivation? How would he initiate contact and target the child? How would he control the environment to evade discovery? Portuguese police cannot ignore the UK's experience in such cases. In the early 90s, a British paedophile group filmed the sexual abuse of Portuguese boys. At one stage, the Americans were so concerned about the role of British paedophiles in Portugal that I was approached about the targeting of schools there. International cooperation should be part of police thinking. However, there is no culture of community policing in Portugal, and they have laws that prevent the discussion of cases. This is clearly the wrong way around. The media are essential in passing coordinated and directed information to the community. In this case, speculation is rife. Confused messages are likely to be given. The parents will be feeling guilty for leaving the children, and even half an hour is a long time if a child wakes up and starts to cry immediately after one leaves the room. This could possibly lead to a woman on her own who has lost a child saying to herself wrongly that the parents did not care for this child and deciding to take the girl home. No paedophile, no conspiracy, just a lonely woman. The window of opportunity for the abductor means that the information given by the parents has to be very accurate. Police must help them to say exactly how long it was since they last saw their child. The parents need to know that if this was an offender who planned the abduction, then there is probably nothing they could have done. I once asked an abductor who had killed girls how we could stop him. He said, "I suppose you would have to chain a child to the mother." But he added, "No, that would not work. I would take both." The Times wrote, "If Madeleine McCann was abducted by a paedophile, there is a chance that she is still alive and can be saved by sensitive policing," according to Ray Wire, a sexual crimes consultant. Lately, there have been more and more cases where there has been an element of planning and an attempt to keep the child alive. The police must avoid doing anything to make the kidnapper panic. If he believes that they are about to move in and catch him, he may become so alarmed that he kills the child to stop her being a witness. He continued, "Portugal is known to attract British paedophiles. A ring of 20 Britons set up there around 1990, filming sex acts with local boys and sending the tapes to Belgium and the Netherlands. Some were later jailed in England. The case helped to persuade the British government to make it illegal for Britons to have sex with underage children abroad. I went to Lisbon and became involved in the aftermath of that investigation. There were still lots of connections and other things going on. There have always been British paedophiles operating in Portugal." It seems then that Wire had fairly recent knowledge of a ring of British expat paedophiles in Portugal. Months later, the McCanns had a day with the Wires at their home. This is how the People reported the story. Kate and Jerry played no part in the disappearance of their daughter Madeleine, one of the world's top crime experts declared last night. Ray Wire, who has given cracker-style testimony to courts since the 1970s, said, "It is absolutely impossible for them to have been involved." He insisted the grief-stricken parents were incapable of doing anything to harm their children. Wire, who's helped nail a string of monsters, including child killer Robert Black, said, "I was with them for several hours, and I could not help but apply some of the practices I use when I'm carrying out assessments of suspects for police and the courts. I can state categorically there is no way they were involved in their daughter's murder or disappearance. They would be incapable of such an act. I have more than 30 years' experience in this field and am used to people trying to hide dark secrets. There was no sign of any such deceit. It is absolutely impossible for them to have been involved." He said for 3 days all they could see in their minds was Madeleine lying dead. They were in complete agreement she'd been taken by a predator, abused and killed. They were certain they would never see her alive again. The image of her lying murdered hardly left them, and they expected at any time to receive the news that her body had been found. The article was a great boost for the McCanns. Wire died just 5 months after those 7 hours with the McCanns. Obituaries praised him. The Guardian summed him up as a trailblazing therapist with a unique approach to sex offenders, one of the world's leading experts on sexual crime. The Times was just as exuberant. He was renowned for his pioneering work with people who sexually abused children. But there was a much darker side to Ray Wire, which makes one ask what his real connection was to the McCanns and why he praised them so much. After he started his Gracewell Clinic for sex offenders in 1988, it continually attracted controversy. He was known to have an obsession with witchcraft and the occult. He was much criticised for claiming that there was a major satanic child abuse ring in Nottingham. No evidence of it was found. 3 years later, he repeated the same disastrous mistake in Scotland, where one commentator said, "Perhaps the most disturbing of all is the evidence that the investigation team was influenced by Ray Wire, a former probation officer who describes himself as an independent sexual abuse consultant." Though the local authority refused to admit it, the investigators attended a special 3-day training program in October 1991, organized by Mr. Wire's Gracewell Institute. Only after this did the allegations of satanic ritual abuse begin to flow. Almost unbelievably, Despite this second setback, Wyatt tried the same thing again in Wales 3 years later. Another bout of satanic abuse hysteria broke out after Wyatt was paid thousands of pounds to run a 3-day conference on the subject. 3 years later, Wyatt was at the centre of another controversy. Channel 4's The Devil Amongst Us allowed 5 paedophiles to speak about their perverted desires, with one, Paul, quoted as saying, "I would love to come out and have an open relationship with a child where we did the same things as heterosexuals do with each other. Society needs to stop discriminating against paedophiles." One of Wyatt's major techniques for controlling the desires of sex offenders was what he called masturbation satiation. Offenders were required to watch pornographic films of an extreme nature as part of the therapy, while masturbating for a minimum of 1.5 to 2 hours. Wyatt claimed that if they masturbated frequently over a long period of time, they would reach saturation level and no longer be tempted to engage in criminal sexual acts. It is a claim that has never been verified, except by Wyatt himself, who said that none of those who underwent this treatment ever reoffended. Wyatt told probation officers that such treatment should be mandatory. Wyatt was into witchcraft and the occult, and after his death, his name appeared on the Elm Guest House list. Elm House in Barnes, West London, was used for years by politicians and celebrities for sex with boys, who were taken for that purpose from children's homes far and wide. The allegations have been investigated under Operation Fernbridge and are ongoing. The guest list, shown here, is document number 63 in a list of documents examined by the Metropolitan Police in what many people perceive as yet another series of establishment cover-ups of high-level paedophile rings. These scribbled notes were written down by Chris Foy while interviewing Carol Kasser, the ex-wife of the former owner of Elm House, in 1992. The seventh name on the list is Dr. Ray Wire, Gracewell Clinic. These are mostly the names of actual patrons of the guest house who were abusing young boys. For other names on the list, Wikipedia tells us prominent people who attended parties at Elm Guest House are alleged to have included Liberal MP Sir Cyril Smith, the Conservative MP Sir Nicholas Fairbairn, the Soviet spy Anthony Blunt, the former British diplomat Sir Peter Hayman, and the Foreign Office barrister Colin Peters, who was later jailed in 1989 for being part of a network which abused over 100 boys. According to The Independent, other alleged visitors to the guest house include a Sinn Féin politician, a Labour MP, and several Conservative politicians. The Independent on Sunday reported that at least 3 men named in documents as visitors to the Elm guest house were later convicted of multiple sexual offences against children. To summarise then, Ray Wyatt was a creepy, witchcraft and sex-obsessed individual who was also a probable child abuser. Why did the McCanns want to spend a day with him and his wife? During the weeks that followed Madeleine's disappearance, one person local to Prideaux also offered the McCanns hospitality. That was Sir Clement Freud, grandson of Sigmund Freud and brother of Lucian Freud. He was also the father of Matthew Freud, whom I mentioned in my first Madeleine film and who married Rupert Murdoch's daughter Elizabeth. In her book, Kate McCann says that at the beginning of July, she got this letter from Freud. "Dear McCanns, I have a house in Prideaux, been ashamed of the intrusion to your lives by the media, and if you would care to come to lunch stroke dinner at any time before Wednesday next, do ring and let me know. I cook decent meals. Sincerely, Clement Freud." According to Kate McCann, they accepted the invitation, taking with them the twins, Kate's cousins Sandy and Tricia Cameron, and their PR agent Justine McGuinness, who was acting more or less as an assistant to their PR spokesman Clarence Mitchell. They went at midday, and Freud's first words to Kate were, "Can I interest you in a strawberry vodka?" She gratefully accepted, and then sat down to what she called a bloody marvellous lunch. McCanns kept in touch with Sir Clement. On the 3rd of September, the McCanns learned that they might be made formal suspects. At 10 p.m. that day, the McCanns went round to see him for comfort and support, where Kate this time was offered, quote, "a giant glass of brandy." And as we all now know, On the 14th of June 2015, we saw these banner headlines. Sir Clement Freud exposed as a paedophile.
Sir Clement Freud accused of abusing two girls.
These allegations surfaced in ITV's documentary the next day. Exposure, abused and betrayed, a life sentence.
The internet had for years carried gossip that he had abused more than just two children.
By all accounts, his attack on these girls had been violent. His wife, Lady Freud, who must have known about her husband's conduct, publicly apologised for his behaviour. A few days later, the press announced that there was a long history of emails between the McCanns and Freud after the McCanns returned to England. More details then emerged about Freud, including the revelation that when he was elected to Parliament as MP for Ely in 1973, he for many years shared his parliamentary office with the notorious Rochdale paedophile and fellow Liberal MP Sir Cyril Smith. So, what is the significance of this? We have now met one certain paedophile, Clement Freud, and a witchcraft and sex-obsessed probable paedophile, Ray Wire. Both of these men have a connection with notorious paedophile Cyril Smith. Wire and Smith were apparently regulars at Elm House. In my first film, I exposed the huge influence of the security services in the Madeleine McCann case. I named MI5, Special Branch, other branches of the security services, and government-funded security firms like Control Risks Group. There was a top-secret command group set up on the 8th of May 2007 under the chairmanship of Matt Baggett, the head of Leicestershire Police. These agencies were in direct contact with the McCanns. I ask, given Ray Wire's and Clement Freud's connection with Cyril Smith and possibly other paedophiles, how likely was it that government security services were fully aware of and monitoring all of them? I suggest it would be a certainty. In fact, these paedophiles must have been assets of the security services. The fact that the McCanns were not warned about these paedophiles adds weight to the assertion that they were assets of the security services and not merely being monitored by them. There has been an extremely close connection for 10 years now between the McCanns and the former head of the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Unit, CEOP, Jim Gamble. He has spoken regularly on the McCanns' behalf. This was despite the obvious fact that the McCanns had publicly confessed in two national newspapers on the 5th of August 2007 to having left three young children, all under the age of four, in a vulnerable situation on their own for significant periods of time, six nights in a row, and on their own evidence, clearly failed to protect them. Of course, watchers of my films know different by now, but Gamble says he believes the McCanns and must also believe that they left their children alone for long enough to be abducted. Many questioned why an organisation with the words child protection in its title should feature the McCanns. Gamble, from Northern Ireland, got his first job in the Royal Ulster Constabulary, after which his rise was meteoric. An intelligence officer, during the Kincora Boys Home child abuse scandal, he rapidly became the head of the RUC's anti-intelligence unit. After that, he became head of Special Branch for the Belfast region. At the end of my first Madeleine film, I noted how the Kincora Boys Home was used by MI5, who were supplying boys to prominent politicians, then filming the disgusting abuse on hidden cameras which they had installed. The films were then used to blackmail the politicians. What Gamble's role was at the time is not known. An article on Jim Gamble titled, "Was Jim Gamble a Corrupt Police Officer in Northern Ireland and Did He Authorise or Cover Up Murders? A Look at the Findings of Operation Ballast" by Baroness Noala O'Loan on the Northern Ireland Security Services deals specifically with the series of murders in the 1990s. It was devastating. Senior Special Branch officers murdered people, covered up murders and were thoroughly corrupt. The corruption and abuse was widespread, of epidemic proportions. Gamble had a senior position at this time, but fortunately for him and the others, they were never actually named in the report. So perhaps we will never know how deep his role was in these murky matters. From Northern Ireland, he became Deputy Chief Constable of the National Crime Squad, which later morphed into the serious organised crime agency SOCCER. There he was given special responsibility for dealing with the problem of child sexual abuse, and in 1999 was asked to head up the controversial Operation OAR. This operation was inspired by information received from the United States. The authorities there had gained access to the database of Landslide, a place where people could access child sexual images by paying a fee by credit card. Wikipedia claims there were 3,744 arrests and 1,451 convictions, but also noted that the validity of the police procedures was later questioned as errors in the investigation resulted in large numbers of false arrests. There were at least 33 suicides resulting from Operation OAR.
We've had as many people kill themselves as we have identified those that abuse children. When you go through the door and show people that you're executing a warrant under the Protection of Children Act 1978, you have just blown the biggest hole in somebody's life that could possibly ever happen. Until now, they thought that they were safe in their environment, downloading child abuse images on a computer. They thought that it was acceptable for them to download indecent images on their computer. And you've suddenly gone in and told them, actually, it's not, you're a paedophile. We ruin their lives.
Criticism of it centred around whether or not the owners of credit cards in Landslide's database actually accessed any sites containing child porn, unlike the US, where investigators had to determine in advance whether or not credit card subscribers had actually purchased child porn. Investigative journalist Duncan Campbell exposed these flaws in a series of articles in 2005 and 2007. There were many reports that the list of those investigated by Operation OAR included senior politicians, judges, celebrities and other VIPs, but none of these were prosecuted apart from Pete Townsend of The Who. And on the back of what was hailed as a success, the Blair government in 2006 appointed Jim Gamble the head of a brand new task force, the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Service, or CEOP. Jim Gamble was right on Madeleine's case from day one. Within days, he interfered with the Portuguese police investigation by making a public appeal for people who had been in Praia da Luz around the time of the McCann's holiday to send him and not the Portuguese police their holiday photographs. He issued an email address which ensured that any images came direct to him. At this time, Leicestershire police were also involved in supposedly assisting the Portuguese police. So for what reason was CEOP 2,000 miles away in London involved in collecting these holiday photographs? Were they working with or against the Portuguese police? According to a source close to the investigation in the United Kingdom, several hundred photos were sent to the British authorities, most of them downloaded via internet pages specially created for the occasion. Jim Gamble stated, "We will then evaluate these images at a rate of 1,000 images an hour, so that before long we are sending the significant information to the Portuguese authorities." But did the Portuguese police ever get these images? No. Gonçalo Amaral wrote in his book, "None of these images ever reached us." Along with Gamble, two other characters keep popping up who seem to move in the same circles. One is a former police officer turned criminologist and self-professed child abuse expert, Mark Williams Thomas. The other is Dr. Joe Sullivan, a psychologist. Soon after Madeleine was reported missing, the press reported, "Highly respected forensic psychologist Dr. Joe Sullivan arrived in Praia da Luz within days of Madeleine's disappearance as part of a so-called cracker team with Detective Chief Superintendent Graham Hill. He returned to the UK on the 9th of May 2007. He wasn't there for long then, but he had been specifically selected to go to Praia da Luz by the Foreign and Commonwealth Office and was one of Gamble's trusted aides, having worked alongside him at CEOP. I also mentioned Mark Williams Thomas. He was also quick off the mark to get to Praia da Luz. He was already making several strong and detailed criticisms of the Portuguese investigation, even though he can have known little about what was really going on in the PJ offices in Portimao. Gamble, from 2007 onwards, heavily featured Madeleine on the CEOP website and in various CEOP publications, regularly using photos of Madeleine and the McCanns. Mark Williams-Thomas continued to appear regularly on Sky News, pontificating about paedophiles and speculating about what might have happened to Madeleine. On the 15th of September 2007, the Gazeta Digital website published an article by Duarte Levy and Paolo Rees about Mark Williams-Thomas and his views on the Madeleine McCann case. After hearing him on Sky News, they wrote, "Mark Williams-Thomas urged Portuguese police to ditch the case against the McCanns, a case that he classified as ludicrous, and follow another lead that he thinks could take the PJ to the real kidnapper." And this is what he described as the similar disappearance of an 8-year-old girl, Joanna Cipriano, 2 years earlier. This comment, which went unchallenged, was almost unbelievable. The truth of the matter is that Joanna Cipriano's mother, Leonor Cipriano, and her brother brutally murdered the little girl after she discovered them committing incest. Both later made full confessions, the one by her brother being detailed, graphic, and gruesome in the extreme. The person who led the successful investigation was Gonçalo Amaral. Both murderers were sentenced to 16 years and are still in jail today. It beggars belief that Williams-Thomas could get away with such a monumental untruth in front of millions of viewers. A professed expert, he had successfully fed the abduction myth. But then it was the Murdoch-owned and controversial Sky News that was giving Williams-Thomas the airtime. On the 14th of September 2007, Mark Williams-Thomas was questioned by Paolo Rees about his business relationship with the McCanns. He then admitted that his company, WT Associates, had a contract to provide services to the McCanns. But when asked to confirm in writing some details of that business relationship, he changed his initial answer, denying any relationship and admitting only that he has been in contact with the press officers for the family. It looks to me then that Williams-Thomas was probably not an independent commentator on this case. On the 5th of November 2009, CEOP, under Jim Gamble's direction, produced a one-minute video called A Minute for Madeleine. It was a CEOP production featuring an age-progressed sketch of Madeleine as she might be aged about six. And it was narrated by Gamble's friend, Dr. Joe Sullivan, also from Northern Ireland. According to the McCannfiles.com website, Sullivan helped in the production of and personally narrated the video and appealed directly to the person keeping a secret about Madeleine, who knows who's involved in her disappearance and who may have been groomed by the perpetrators to stay quiet. At the time, ITN News reported that the criminal psychologist behind a new Madeleine McCann appeal, Dr. Joe Sullivan, has told ITV News that her abductor is very likely to strike again. In October 2009, the McCanns had a private interview with Jim Gamble. Following that private interview, several press reports indicated that the then Labour Home Secretary, Alan Johnson, had asked Jim Gamble to recommend a new British police force to carry out a review and possibly a full investigation into Madeleine's disappearance. It was baffling why the Home Secretary, knowing Jim Gamble's extreme closeness to the McCanns, should choose him to recommend who should carry out an independent review into Madeleine's alleged disappearance. These discussions continued when Theresa May became Home Secretary in 2010 and led to the setting up of the Met Police's Operation Grange investigation. But as I said earlier, this has never been a real investigation. It was a psyop from day one. It almost seemed as if Gamble was running the McCann case. Gamble was recommending what form any review of the Madeleine McCann case would take. There is little doubt that Gamble shaped the Operation Grange review, which, as I've shown in my films, ended up only considering an abduction theory about Madeleine, and has ended up being a £13 million total failure. In May 2010, a general election saw a change of personnel and Theresa May was made Home Secretary. She soon proposed that CEOP be brought back under the Serious Organised Crime Agency, now the National Crime Agency. Seeing it as a threat to his power,
Gamble told May that he would resign his post as CEOP chief executive if she went ahead with her plans. This prompted the McCanns, supported by some of the media, to loudly praise and thank Gamble for his excellent work and condemn the Home Secretary for effectively scrapping CEOP as a separate organisation. A huge loss to child protection, they cried. Once again, this suggested a very close tie between the McCanns and Jim Gamble. Also, why were the McCanns so thankful to Gamble? After all, he hadn't found Madeleine. I believe they were thanking him for protecting them from prosecution. But Theresa May did go ahead with her plans and swiftly accepted Gamble's resignation. Since then, he has formed a very profitable business, Inc, which sells expensive courses on child protection to social services and child protection staff. But despite his new career, Gamble continues to tweet about the Madeleine McCann case on Twitter, aggressively challenging anyone on Twitter who questions the abduction myth.